What's up, everyone? Finally back with another edition of the Poker Blog. Today we're headed out to a private game. Sorry about the long break. There was a while where the games weren't running, then there was a while where it was super, super cold. Then, unfortunately, or fortunately, hard to tell which, I got a job, so that lowered my available time to make videos and to go play poker in general. So, we are back after it. We've got a couple sessions built up. We're gonna be bringing you weekly uploads, so it is time to get in the action. Lines up with March Madness, which is about to start. So I don't know if you guys are into the NCAA bracket and stuff like that. I know almost everyone is. If you are, consider heading over to stumpthespread.com. It's a great resource. If you want to win your yearly office pool, they'll help you. They've got a YouTube channel. They'll have all kinds of information for you on college basketball and all the other major sports, which they've been killing it in lately. UFC, NBA, whole nine yards. Baseball season's coming up, so they're getting after it. There's a link down in the description to all their stuff, so check that out if you're interested at all. Let's go ahead and hop into some poker action. Private game session. Feel like we played pretty well. Let's get in there. What's up, guys? Welcome to another episode of the Poker Vlog. Today we are headed out to a cash game in Springfield, Missouri. Games are going again, feeling great. Unfortunately, it is a balmy 19 degrees. There is ice all over the road, as you're gonna see here in just a second. So we are taking it pretty carefully on our way there. Hopefully we can get there in one piece. Gonna be buying it for 500 bucks. Hopefully we can run up a stack. Feeling pretty good. Been a long time since we played. Just been thinking about poker a lot. I don't think I can say that I've been studying necessarily, but I've definitely been in the streets a little bit, so feeling good about the mental. Went and played some basketball today, it went really well. So yeah, time to get out there, time to get in it, let's go. Okay, first hand we're gonna go over, I look down at Jack 10 of diamonds, starting this hand with about $485, and we are in the hijack. So the action ends up folding to me in this straddle pot. I go ahead and raise it up to 20 bucks, my standard straddle pot sizing, and a player in the cutoff decides to 3-bet it to 65. So obviously Jack 10 usually is not in my open and then call a 3-bet range. Like usually I would just let this one go. However, against this in particular player, I know that if I hit my hand or really make anything at all, I can expect him to barrel off pretty often and in really weird ways. So this is definitely somebody we're looking to mix it up against as much as possible. He's sitting on my left, so we have absolutely no problem with that. So we're off to see a flop, which comes down ace to nine with the ace and two of hearts. So unfortunately, we don't pick up any diamonds. We do have some straight possibilities. There are a lot of good turn cards for us. I end up checking, and unfortunately, he leads out for $100. So $100 into a pot of like 130. I don't know. I think with this sizing, we're just gonna have to let it go. He's gonna have so many aces, we're gonna be so far behind. Sucks to lose the first hand, but we're gonna be trying to play as many hands against this player as we possibly can. So a little bit later on, we're making a mistake right out of the gate. We look down at ace jack offsuit. We're in the big blind, starting this hand with about $420. I make the mistake of opening to $15 in a straddle pot. I should be opening to $20 in a straddle pot. That's like my normal size. No idea why I did that. Only the button, who is the straddler, makes the call. So we're off to see a flop, which comes down a pretty good one for us. Flop is ace 10-4 with the ace and four of spades. So we flop top pair, very good kicker here. I decide time to go for some value. I bet 20 bucks and the button makes the call. So that's totally fine. That's kind of what we're going for here. Turn comes down four of clubs, so pairs the board. Not really too bothering. He can definitely have some fours here. That's how wide ranges are in this game. Don't really think he has too many, so we're not gonna let that slow us down. We're gonna try to get some more value. We bet out 50 bucks and he makes the call again. The river comes down, another ace. So now we have top full house on this double paired board. So the question is, how can we get more money? He's been very sticky so far. Now we're really hoping he has a like disbelieving four. I go ahead and bet out $115. I actually don't like this sizing. I think I should either go way larger to make it look much bluffier or way smaller. Obviously, since I don't like this size, you can probably tell what's coming. Thinks about it for a while and ends up making the fold. So we don't win the maximum on that hand, but it's good to get a little healing after losing some there with the old Jack 10 in the very first hand.
Hey guys, in this hand we're looking down at pocket jacks from under the gun plus one, starting this hand with about $500. So feel pretty good, got a nice hand, gonna go ahead and open it up to 15 bucks here, and in classic private game fashion, we end up getting three callers. So we're gonna be going very multi-way to the flop. I guess we can't be too upset, you want people in there creating action, but yeah, oh well, we'll take it. Ends up, we're pretty happy because the flop comes down jack 6-5, so we've got top set here on a pretty connected board when things start to get a little bit weird. The big blind ends up donk leading into us for $40. So kind of a weird situation. We have to decide whether or not to raise it up now or just make the call and slow play. I'm pretty sure on this particular board, it's time to raise it up. There are a lot of terrible cards that can come on the turn. So we go ahead and bump it up to $155 and the big blind goes into the tank. He is well into the tank. He's talking a little bit, not like a crazy amount. With how long he's thinking about it, I'm starting to assume that he must actually have a pretty decent hand. Maybe he's thinking about it this long with two clubs and is just deciding if he wants to gamble, or maybe he has some sort of combo draw, or maybe has like top pair, top kicker. Not really sure what he can have here. There's a lot of options. He actually talks a little bit about the wife awake versus wife asleep ranges here. Apparently, if your wife is awake, you want to go ahead and gamble and maybe head home early. And if your wife is asleep, you can just stay all night. So eventually, apparently, the ranges dictated that he should go ahead and make a fold here. He lays it down, saying he had ace jack with a jack of clubs. So, oh well, this one doesn't get us the maximum, but we'll take it. A little bit after that pocket jack's hand, I look down at ace deuce suited from the button, starting this hand off about $600. There's one limper to me. I go ahead and raise it up to 15 bucks. Maybe should have made it 20. I don't think it would make a difference though. And we get the big blind to call and the cutoff limper also makes the call. So obviously a flop, multi-way as per usual. We are feeling okay about our hand. Flop comes down. Pretty interesting one. The flop is queen jack jack with two hearts, so definitely a whiff for us. I think this is actually a good spot to just check back and kind of give up on this hand since we really don't have anything going for us. Unfortunately, I decide that that is not the route we're gonna take. Once the action checks to me, I bet out $20 and the big blind will end up being our only caller. So I think this is bad because he's going to have more jacks than me for sure. Maybe not more queens than me, but I don't really think this is a good spot. And obviously, he can have all the flush draws and things of that nature. So ends up, turn comes down, the king of diamonds, big blind checks to me. I can decide to go ahead and continue telling this story by betting out $45. He does not think about it for very long before putting in the call again, and we're off to see a river card. So the river card is a pretty interesting one for us, and I think in the long run ends up, well, I don't know, you guys will see how it plays out, because the river is the ace of clubs. So now we have top pair, we've got some showdown value, we can beat any like middling pocket pairs. When he checks to me, I snap check it back, show my hand, and unfortunately he flips over king 10 of spades. So he had the nut straight here, and we lose this one. So we're back to no table footage for the rest of this video. The reason for this being, I was able to move over into my opponent's seat while he got up to go get a drink or something. And it was very obvious that he would clearly be able to see my cards every time I looked at him in my phone, like using the camera. So if you guys have any tips for how I can avoid this, or if you know how any of the other big bloggers do it, I'm thinking about maybe getting some sort of like screen protector for my phone, like one of those ones they have for laptops so you can't see like from the sides. So hopefully that will help and we won't have to worry about this anymore. But I can't play without thinking about it if I think that my opponent to my left could look down and see my hand every single hand. So anyway, we look down at A6 of clubs from the cutoff, starting this hand with about $500. Middle position one, who's a quiet player I've never seen before, makes it 15 bucks. I decide with this hand, I can call. The big blind calls and under the gun also calls. So we're obviously looking to see some clubs here. Flop comes down a very interesting one for us. The flop is 6-4-6 with two diamonds. So we flop trips here with the best kicker possible. Pretty great spot, very multi-way still. Action checks the middle position one, who bets $20. I decide to just slow play this and make the call. I don't really know if I should be slow playing here so multi-way on a pretty wet board, especially since it was a $15 open sizing and there were so many players still in the pot. People will call very loosely. So yeah, I think I should have just went ahead and raised right off the bat. If I do that though, I turn my hand very face up. So I don't really know. Let me know in the comments what you think I should actually do in that hand. In this particular spot, I just make the call. Ends up, the big blind also makes the call. So we do get a little bit more money in there. I guess that's okay. Turn comes down, eight of hearts. So another very connected card. Now we have like straights to be worried about. A lot to be worried about on this board. Big blind checks. I think that I hear the middle position one player check. And I'm literally holding like $50 out to bet when he bets out 45. So I'm really weirded out, feeling unsettled because I was about to act out of turn and what looks like it's gonna be a pretty big pot in like a really weird way. It also seems like he didn't notice that I was about to do this. So anyway, I'm a little bit off my game. I just go ahead and make the call and so does the other player in the hand. So we're going three ways to the river, which comes down pretty sure the absolute worst card in the deck. It's the seven of diamonds. So the front door flush draw comes through. We have every straight in the world just made it. So I don't really know what to do. Obviously I'm not going for value here. I'm probably just folding if somebody bets. Action on the river ends up going check, check, check. So I end up flipping my cards over, thinking there's some chance here that I could actually be good. Turns out that the big blind was on a flush draw the whole time. He had king nine. So of diamonds. So we lose this one. I feel like we played it pretty bad. I'm not like super, super upset in hindsight. I was really upset in the moment with how I played it, but in hindsight, I'm not that upset. I actually think that I could have won a lot more money if things would have went a little bit differently. And I would not have won very much if I would have just like started blasting after it immediately. And the guy that flopped the flush draw was never folding his flush draw. So, oh well, not very happy with how I played it, but not nearly as distraught as I was at the time. So a little while later, we played the biggest hand that I've played this year. It's a monster one, it's pretty crazy, so buckle up. I look down at 7-5 of hearts, yeah, 7-5 of hearts, from the button, starting this hand with about $400. Under the gun makes it 15 bucks, under the gun plus one calls, I call, and the small blind, who is the player who I've been looking to play pots against, who I definitely want to be playing hands against, makes it $51. So a weird amount for sure, but I don't think that's going to scare us off, especially after the big blind calls, under the gun plus one calls. So there's a ton of money in there. We're going to try to scoop it up with our very middling one gapper. So we call, huge pot already, head to the flop, which comes down a pretty interesting one for us. Flop is four of hearts, three of hearts, 10 of clubs. So we flop a gut shot, straight flush draw. Not too shabby for getting in there with 7-5 of hearts. The small blind, who is the crazy player, bets $225. So I'm immediately like, holy crap, what does he have here? I guess he could have aces. Like, not a whole lot makes sense for him. Also, he's a crazy person. Like, he could literally be doing this with any two cards almost. Like, he could have ace king here and just be barreling off. So the opponent in the big blind, who is also a very loose player, shoves all in for less than 225. I want to say it was somewhere around 200 or 150 ish, something like that. Action gets to me, and I think about it for a long time. So I've got like $350 here in front of me. Don't really know what to do. I've gotten myself into this weird, sticky situation with 7-5 of hearts. I'm thinking about it. Finally, if I get to the thought process, if I'm going to, which is definitely a bad one, but if I'm going to be calling a three bet here with 7-5 of hearts, flop this well, this multi-way, have to be getting almost okay odds to call. I think I'm definitely getting okay odds to call if my hearts are live. I think it's time to get it in. So I go ahead and shove. The small blind then goes into the tank. This is for like 125 more into a very large pot. I'm not sure why he was tanking for so long, but he tanks it out and eventually calls. So this is a really big pot. We're sweating it a little bit, feel kind of dumb. No, we're drawing super live though. Can we find the six of hearts? So we're off to see the turn, which comes down the six of clubs. So we turn the nuts. I wasn't even thinking about that. I was literally like, okay, I have to hit a flush here to win. or the straight flush. Wasn't even thinking about hitting an offsuit six. So we immediately bang off the straight. River comes down, the king of clubs, so that completes a backdoor flush draw, so I no longer have the nuts, and I'm a little bit nervous. I flip my hand over. Nobody seems too upset, which is a little bit weird. Usually there's a little bit more emotion going on. Both of them look down at their cards for like a while before mucking them. So we take this one down, huge pot. We got a nice big stack now. Time to play some poker. So a good while later, we actually go a bit card dead still, not picking up a lot of hands when we look down at Queen Jack of Clubs from the hijack, starting this hand at about $1,200. So we're feeling pretty good. Under the gun straddle, action folds to me. I go ahead and open up to 20 bucks, which is my correct sizing in a straddle pot. We get one caller from the button who is one of the crazy players that was involved in the hand before, and we are off to see a flop. Flop is a very good one for us. Flop is 10-9-4 with two hearts. So we don't love that there's two hearts, but there is a club, so we've got a little bit of something cooking. I go ahead and bet out 30 bucks, and he makes the call without thinking about it for very long. So not really sure. He can have pretty much any two cards at this point. Turn comes down the ace of hearts. So it immediately completes the front door flush draw. Not feeling very good about that card. So we end up both checking. The river comes down the eight of clubs. So fantastic card for me. Obviously I hit my straight. So I've got the nut straight for sure. Not the nut, but I don't have a flush. Not feeling very good about this. Don't think I'm gonna get too much value from very many hands. And if I bet, I am really, really opening myself up to getting check raised against the only player at the table who has as many chips as me and someone who I know is definitely capable of just firing off to try and put me in a terrible spot. So I end up betting $50. Not really sure if I even like betting here. I don't think I'm getting called by worse ever, and I'm just putting myself in a bad position. He ends up folding, so we take that one down. Feel pretty good about it, I guess. Not very long after that, I look down at pocket fours from the hijack, starting this hand with about 1250. Action folds to me, I open up to $15 in this non-straddle pot, so good job keeping my sizing consistent. And the player in the button that we played the last hand against makes the call. So we're off to see a flop, which comes down ace high. No four for us, that's okay. On an ace high flop like this, when we were the pre-flop opener, I think we can definitely go ahead and just try and represent an ace. So I bet out $20 and he makes the call. So actually don't expect him to fold here on the flop to me like ever. That's not really his style. So we're just gonna have to keep barreling off. Turn comes down, the queen of diamonds. So kind of an interesting card, puts two diamonds out there. So there's a backdoor flush draw now. I think I'm just gonna go ahead and rep it again. I bet out $45 and the button calls. So I like my sizing here. I think it's pretty consistent with what I would do with like ace queen, ace king, ace jack, ace 10, things like that. So I think it makes a lot of sense. He ends up making a call. So we've got a pretty decent sized pot brewing here. I do not have anything. So it's gonna be time to probably fire off the last barrel here on the river, depending on what we end up getting. River comes down a very interesting card. The river is the king of diamonds. So the backdoor flush draw completes. Any 10 now has a straight. Pretty weird, very draw heavy board. I decide time to load it up, time to go for it. I bet out $120 and he goes well into the tank. Now I know this is a player that's capable of making some loose calls or some loose raises. I don't know if this is really a good play. He thinks about it for a long, long time. Eventually basically implies that I probably don't have like a stone cold bluff here in me and slides his cards into the middle. So we're very happy that this bluff works out. I know you asked about this hand. When I say watch the vlog and you'll see the hand, watch the vlog and you'll see the hand. So, all right, on to the next one. There isn't really too much to tell about this hand. It's just a little bit interesting because I'm playing against the exact same player that I've played the previous two hands against. I look down to ace, queen of diamonds, and I call a three bet. So we've got about $120 in the pot, heading to the flop, which is all blanks. I don't connect at all. We both check, turn's a blank, we both check. River's a queen, so I end up with top pair, top kicker. I go ahead and check, hoping to induce a bluff. He does not take the bait, just checks back, I flip my cards over and he flips over ace king. So I got very lucky on the river, obviously, in this three bet pot, but did not win very much. I guess maybe I should put in a bet here, but it's gonna be hard to get called by worse. So I think I'm okay with the way I played it. Not a very interesting hand, just thought I'd throw it in here because it was against the same guy. The last hand of the video, against the same guy, again, I've got ace king this time. I go ahead and three bet him and he makes the call. So we've got about $120 in this pot as well, maybe more like $130. Flop comes down, 7-6-5, so terrible flop for me, way, way, way better for his range. Action ends up checking through, turn comes down to 2. I'm not looking to fire off this time either. This is still a range that favors him way, way more than me, or a board that favors his range way, way more than me. So we're not doing anything too crazy. River comes down to 9, so now any 8 has a straight. He's gonna have all the 8s. I'm literally only gonna have pocket 8s in this spot. So obviously terrible spot for me. He bets out $100 this time. I'm go ahead, get out of here. Time to rack him up. Had a very good session, feeling great about things. Let's cash out, get out of here.
Guys, that's all for this one. Nice winning session. Feel like we played pretty well. Don't forget to give this video a thumbs up, comment down below, let me know what you think of the video, of how I played, of anything in general. If you're excited about March Madness coming up, don't forget to head over to stumpthespread.com. They'll have some cool information there for you. If you're curious about the game that I play in or have questions for me about that, feel free to follow me on Instagram or comment below and I will definitely get back to you. I read all the comments and I respond to almost all of them. I really like to stay in touch with everybody that follows me and supports me. It means a lot, so thank you very, very much. I'll be back next week with another video. Stay tuned for that. See you guys next time.